Morning, ladies, gents, and jerks. It's been quite a while since I've done a video. And firstly, one thing I want to show, I got a new gun. It is a 1897 model Winchester, or 1893 model Winchester pump. It's got a bit of a problem in that the ejector or extractor doesn't quite work right, but still it's a rather nice gun. I rather like it. I also got a dog. Come here. I'm gonna pick him up. Ah. So this is, I've been calling him Doofus, and kind of, it's fitting because he just look kind of, he looks like a dummy, but he's a good boy in training. Let me set you over here. Stay. But he didn't stay. The reason I'm making this video is a video I've been meaning to do for quite a long time. Do not chew my shoe, please. Been meaning to do for quite a long time is. There's no such thing as a war of attrition. Now, this was prompted by Ukraine. The great patriotic war of Ukraine that they're fighting right now, to borrow a phrase from Russia. It's been rather fascinating, because I've been paying attention to that since even before it actually began. And the fascinating part is how the... some people call them tankies. Some people call them vatniks. Some say Russian bots. I've been saying Soviet clanker. Because everything Russia has is built in the Soviet Union. But the story goes, or went, from at the start of the full-scale invasion, the war started in 2014. There's a whole lot of crap backlogging in that, but that's not what we're on about. At the start of this, it started as like, oh, look how much territory they've taken! And one guy said, look, they've taken entire Britain's worth of territory from the Ukrainians! Whoa, they're so awesome! And then the Kiev offensive failed. Then the Kharkiv front collapsed, and then the Lyman front collapsed, like 10,000 kilometers were liberated in a week. And then Kherson was liberated, and suddenly, territory didn't matter anymore. It's like, war of attrition, war of attrition, war of attrition! And their argument was, yeah, Russia's losing more, but they have more to lose. War of attrition, they'll win! No! Wars of attrition don't actually exist. Attrition's a tool, a very important tool. But it's just a tool, just like logistics, which tie a lot into attrition, but it's a tool. Wars are won through maneuver. Territory is what matters. Positioning is what matters. Go to Gettysburg. Ask the slavers how that positioning mattered. Ask them about that. Well, anything, in any regard, positioning matters. There's no such thing as a war of attrition. The reason the Americans beat the slavers in the U.S. Civil War is because of maneuver, positioning. For example, they start off reclaiming New Orleans, pushing down the Mississippi, reclaiming that, cutting the slavers apart. They outmaneuvered them in Tennessee. Sure, Stonewall Jackson did a lot of fancy-looking maneuvers, but didn't really have any strategic gain. That's one of the big problems the slavers had, is they had some great-looking battles, but not really anything that was strategically of value. And then Sherman's March was a huge thing because it cut the slavers again. And that's, you know, sure, you can argue that Grant, yeah, he lost a lot of dudes, but again, he was on offense. That's part of the reason why the Americans lost more than the slavers, because we were on offense. We could replenish, they couldn't. We dealt them more attrition, and through that enabled maneuver. Shield wall combat. I've been in shield wall combat. The way that works, you attrit the enemy, you take out that guy, take out that guy, and that makes an opening for you to punch through. You use attrition to make room for the maneuver, to outflank them. That's how you win. World War I, same thing. It's probably the peak gap between defensive firepower and offensive power, because firepower with the trenches, machine guns, and artillery, the defenders had such a huge advantage that any sort of maneuver was tough. So you got a couple of guys with a Maxim gun on a hill, deep trench lines, barbed wire, and pre-sighted artillery. Good luck. A dozen guys could fend off hundreds. Offense became very difficult. That's why it ground to such a stalemate. But, you know, the improvements in aviation technology and tanks and all that tilted the balance and refinement in tactics, like the Sturmtruppen, you know, the trench raids. You would kind of bring that up, and then finally through seizing the trenches, moving the goalposts, or moving the battle lines, through maneuver, going back to maneuver, the Allies managed to beat the Germans. Same thing in World War II. It was a maneuver. Stalingrad was because maneuver. They cut off the Germans, beat them there, and then they kept pushing. They kept maneuvering, kept taking territories, kept outplaying them. That's how World War II was won. Again, maneuver. It's weird. It always comes back to positionings. Holding the high ground is a very important thing. Especially for, like, artillery. It gives you more view, direct fire, especially because you can see a lot more, you can hit a lot more, you got cleaner line of sights. If you're on a flat land and you got, you know, ye olden cannons, you set your battle line up here, you can see that's a problem. You want them on an elevated position so they can shoot over. You don't really want to shoot directly over your dudes, but it helps having a clean line of sight. And in modern combat, now, in old combat, the high ground and position advantages mattered a lot because fighting uphill sucks. It's not that difficult, except your footwear. You don't understand just how horrible leather-soled boots are until you wear them. That's probably the biggest advantage we have over them, is we got good shoes. We can plant our feet on slick grass and our feet be planted. I've tried fighting on slick grass with leather-soled boots and you're on ice. You just, you're gone. You can't do a lot of stuff. It's rather tricky. So anyone into HEMA or anything like that, try it. You'll notice a lot of your techniques don't so much work. A lot of your steps, you try to do your step and down you go because you don't have traction. It's very useful insight. But yeah, that's the biggest problem with trying to fight uphill is traction. Getting up there. Plus it's more work to get up that hill. But the biggest advantage is thrown weapons. If I've got a javelin, I try to chuck it uphill, it's not going nearly as far, it's not hitting nearly as hard, because it's fighting against gravity. If I'm on top of the hill, it'll go further, and it's coming down with more force. Same thing with bows. I can shoot a bow further when I'm up on the hill, versus trying to shoot up the hill. It's not as big of a deal with rifles, because the sheer velocity on modern firearms is tremendous, like this guy. One of these, with the 20-inch barrel, this is a 16-inch barrel, 3,000 feet per second. Gravity's not going to do that much on a hill. So, yeah, even with these, the hill does matter because you got better line of sight, better coverage, and one other thing is, again, sight, and with the modern rifles, I can see 500 yards. Well, if this was a 308, I could hit at 500 yards. No, I might not be able to. I'm not that great of a shot. I'm more mag dumping the trash. But someone who's a good shot can take something like this, 500 yards. They could spot that guy, boom, put him down. That wasn't as big of a problem back in the ye olden days where bows were like 300 yards, maybe four if you're at a really good hill. So you could do maneuvers at 500 and move in. But with modern rifles, or historic ones, like where are you? This big long son of a bitch. I'm fine, I'll grab you because of your sling. I'll grab you instead. And besides, this one's prettier. Something like this, which is a 1891 pattern Argentinian Mauser. Cock on close, which is kind of neat, but with this, you know, 800, 1,000 yards. Having that high ground, I can see you! Yeah, modern combat, it's not so much about difference in ballistics and energy, it's about I can see you a lot further and I can put you down from a lot further. That's why positions matter. Having a sniper in the high tower, yeah, it's a big deal. Positions matter. That's how you win wars, by taking positions. You take the high ground, you command everything down below. That's why they built castles where they did, because castles in a high commanding position, they own everything down there. It's really hard to do anything when they've got such a stronghold. Nowadays, a couple of riflemen on a high hill, that's a hard position to take. With machine guns too, modern firearms like that, yeah, positions matter. It's not about, you know, just killing a bunch of the enemy. That's why Vietnam was such a shit show, because a lot of times the U.S. would bombard the hell out of an enemy hill. Then they'd storm in with helicopters and all that, kill everybody there, and then go home, and a week later they'd have to do it again because the Vietnamese retook that hill. That war wasn't meant to end, by the way. That was meant to be, like, the war on terror, where it's just perpetually spending American money to kill some non-white people. Yeah, it's a war for profit, which always fun. But anyways, about positioning, yeah, I keep circling back to this, but wars are won through maneuver, not just killing a bunch of people. That's why Vietnam didn't go so well. Now, it wasn't a defeat. Look at the Paris Peace Accords. We forced them into a, just like North and South Korea, but North and South Vietnam. We left for a year, and then they attacked again. We didn't come back, and that's why South Vietnam fell. But, yeah. Wars are not about attrition. It's maneuver. Positioning. Everything is about position. As Mel Brooks said when staking a vampire, it's all about location, location, location. So, yeah. I've reiterated myself more than enough. You get the idea. Wars of attrition don't actually exist. It's maneuver, positioning. Take out the logistics to reduce their numbers so you can maneuver. Attrition leads to maneuver. So, yeah. Anyways, enough restating myself. Tally, stake, and hoe.